two book launches. So first one is by Fakir Aijazuddin Saab. Kisi taaruf ke taluq mohtaj nahi hai. Aap sab jante hain unhe. So I'll just hand over to him. We're a bit short of time. And Aijazuddin Saab.
Doctor Saab is the moderator.
So moderating this session will be Syed Jaffar Ahmed. He's a professor of Pakistan Studies. He heads the Pakistan Studies Center at Karachi University. So Jaffar Sahab, please, you can take over from here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you here in this session. And this session is devoted to the understanding and brief study of a new book by Mr. Aijazuddin. Fakir Aijazuddin, who has written a number of books. And this book we are talking about today is called The Resourceful Fakirs. The Resourceful Fakirs. Apparently the title does not convey much, because when I first heard about the book, I thought which fakirs it is talking about. But later, when I got hold of it, I realized that it's about the three very important fakirs, namely Fakir Aijazuddin, and Fakir Imamuddin, and Fakir Nuruddin, three brothers who played very important role in the court of the Punjabi ruler Ranjit Singh during the period 1780 to 1839. This is a period of some, I think, 60 years, 59 or 60 years. And this is a very important phase of Punjab's history, where we have a ruler who comes from a community which is in minority there, and yet he is a ruler. How he managed the state, and in a period when the things were quite in flux, because East India Company was gradually occupying India, and most of the Indian territory had already come into its control. And there we see a Punjabi ruler who is trying to assert himself, how he did it, how he had been successful, if not fully, to some extent, what had been the weaknesses of his regime. These are the issues which have been addressed in this book. And Fakir Aijazuddin Saab, who has penned down this book in a very brief period, that if we get time later, I'll ask him how can he do that magic. In a period of 7 or 8 months, he penned down this whole book based on primary sources, which is a very difficult task. But he has been known as an art historian, a political commentator, a columnist, educationist, and a chartered accountant. He has written a number of books. More prominent of these have been the ones on the history of art, which is, I would say, a rather difficult discipline. He has also compiled documents and on Pakistan-US relations. There is one book compiled by him, so on and so forth. So without wasting more time, I would simply ask my first question to Fakir Aijazuddin Saab. How you sum up your book? I mean, it's a very difficult task to say in few words what you have done in so many pages, but during in our PhD thesis, Viva, generally my first question to the student is this: how you describe your thesis? So how you describe your thesis, Fakir Saab?
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Saab. I'm deeply grateful, and deeply grateful to all of you for being here, but particularly Amina Saeed and her OUP team for organizing such a brilliant KLF. What is the thesis of the book? Well, one was always told that one should never write about, talk about one's children or talk about one's parents. Unfortunately, in this book, I'm talking about my ancestors, so I'm on safe ground comparatively. The reason for bringing this book about, as you've just mentioned, was to talk about a particular part of Punjab's history when Punjab, for the first and only time in its history, became a kingdom, a finite kingdom. And I just felt that the role that had been played by three Muslim brothers, the Fakir brothers as they were, Aijazuddin, Imamuddin, and Nuruddin, should be given some importance, or at least some acknowledgement, and that is the genesis of the book. With your permission, Dr. Sam, what I'll do is, and with the permission of the audience, I'll run a very quick slide lecture, which will take only about 10 minutes, but it'll help to introduce you to the dramatis personae, the persons who were involved in the story that we will be discussing immediately afterwards. No, just keep going.
No.
Oh, sorry. Good. Just keep going. Okay. The first slide, please go. Yeah. No picture will illustrate the spectacular richness of and grandeur of the Sikh court of Lahore. At the epicenter of this was the Maharaja Ranjit Singh, one-eyed, diminutive, completely illiterate, but nevertheless the potent force in the Punjab with whom both the Sikhs, the Afghans, and then later the British had to cope. The area that he dominated was roughly what is today Punjab, before 1947, let's say, and an area which extended in the north up to Jammu and Kashmir, in the south down to Bahawalpur, in the west up to Kabul, up to Peshawar, and in the east, the border of the Satluj River. Let me introduce you to the family members themselves, the persons I'll be talking about. The first, eldest brother, was Fakir Aijazuddin. The second brother, Fakir Imamuddin. And the third brother, Fakir Nuruddin, my lineal ancestor. They began their careers originally as Hakims. And let me go through the genealogy. If I take you northwards, you'll see that you have the three brothers and their father, Ghulam Muhyiddin and Ghulam Shah. And if I take you southwards, you'll see Fakir Shamsuddin, Fakir Nuruddin, Shamsuddin, Shahabuddin, Najmuddin, Wahiduddin, and Aijazuddin. And I have my granddaughter and grandchildren here, and my daughter, Momina, and her husband, Khalid. So we have four generations, or three generations after me, and we have generations before. Their original profession was as Hakims. And that it was as Hakims that they attracted the attention of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. The earliest reference we have in the family is to Fakir Imamuddin, who was the second brother. And he was asked to negotiate with Sir William Metcalfe, who was the Englishman sent by the British East India Company to negotiate with Maharaja Ranjit Singh. He gave way to Fakir Aijazuddin, the elder brother, who was far more skilled when it came to writing and reading Persian. With the treaty that was negotiated by Metcalfe, Ranjit Singh was recognized by the East India Company as being the unequivocal ruler of the Punjab and the legitimate occupant of the Golden Throne. Maharaja Ranjit Singh, like most rulers of his time, was pressed for money. And so he kept importuning people to try and raise his contributions. He relied upon the third brother, Fakir Nuruddin, who was at that time appointed as the governor of Lahore, and it was Nuruddin's responsibility to receive a number of visitors, William Moorcroft, the British veterinarian, Victor Jacquemont, who was a French botanist, Baron Hugel, and then also James Wolfe, who was Joseph Wolfe, who was a convert from Judaism to Christianity. The most important, perhaps, and most significant for our story is Alexander Burnes. You see him here in disguise, but he arrived and he took a mission where he traveled up the Indus. Now, Ranjit Singh was reluctant to allow this because he knew that the real purpose of Burnes' travel by boat from Karachi, from area near Karachi, up to Lahore, was to be able to navigate and to determine what was the depth and to take soundings of the Indus for future. And there was a reason, a valid reason for this. In 1831, Ranjit Singh was sent some horses, four dray horses, and mares and one mail. And they were sent by William the Fourth. Just to give you a flavor of the time, Dr. Sir, of the kind of correspondence that used to be conducted, all in Persian, by sea court with the East India Company. This is a letter from Maharaja Ranjit Singh. At a happy moment, when the balmy zephyrs of spring were blowing from the garden of friendship and wafting to my senses the grateful perfume of its flowers, Your Excellency's epistle, every letter which is a new-blown rose on the branch of regard, and every word a blooming fruit on the fruit tree of esteem, was delivered to be my best of Burns. Now that is the style in which they used to write in Persian. And not just content with that, he continues that the horses that you've sent me, which actually were used in London for pulling beer cans, the horses which you sent to me in beauty, stature, and disposition surpass the horses of every city and every country in the world. On beholding their shoes, the new moon turned pale with envy and nearly disappeared from the sky. Such horses, the eye of the sun had never beheld in his course through universe. Unable to bestow upon them in writing the praises that they so richly deserve, I am compelled to throw away the reins of the neck of the steed of description and relinquish my pursuit. This is his way of saying, I can't describe them well enough. I just thought I'd give you an idea of the flavor of the kind of communications which we exchanged. Aijazuddin was the author of that letter, fluent in Persian, in Arabic, and subsequently also in English. He was then responsible for the meeting between Lord William Bentinck in October 1831, and it was known as the Field of the Cloth of Gold. In that, the Governor General of the East India Company met Maharaja Ranjit Singh at par. There was a lot of argument about how they should meet, etc. And finally, they met at Rivend? No? Okay. Well, they met close enough. They met at Rupert. And there, as equals, Maharaja Ranjit Singh and Sir William Bentinck as the Governor General, then they crossed from one howdah to the other. If Lord Bentinck had a north-south view, that meant he was looking at the north, towards the south, towards Bahawalpur. Lord Auckland, his successor, had an east-west view. He was obsessed with Afghanistan. And he was responsible for one of the first debacles of any country in Afghanistan, in this case, the British. It was to be the first of a number of defeats. And in this, you see the roots of the Army of the Indus, one branch of which came from Ludhiana, Firozpur, and then came down to Sarkar, and the second, which came up from Karachi, moved up, and they joined at Sarkar, moved to Quetta, and then jointly reached Kabul. When they reached Kabul, they had to go through the Bolan Pass, and in this dramatic picture, done by one of the officers who was present, you can see the kind of scenery that they had to go through, and there they installed Shah Shuja, who had been exiled earlier by Dost Muhammad, and Shah Shuja was in a sense a modern Karzai, planted by the West to govern a country that was essentially ungovernable. In June 1839, Maharaja Ranjit Singh died in Lahore. He was cremated there, and on his cremation pyre, there were four wives and seven maidservants. Now, you don't find maid servants like that nowadays, not even Filipinos. The Samadhi was started in 1839 and completed 10 years later, and was built by my ancestor, Fakir Nuruddin. He was succeeded by Maharaja Khadak Singh, who was addicted to opium. As somebody yesterday teasingly was saying, as is one of our leaders. Not necessarily opium, but please. Next, his son, but only Maharaja for a day, was Nonihal Singh. He died in an accident in his hurry to become Maharaja, and he then crossed from, he was passing under a parapet and it fell on him and he died. So they were dead, father and son, within a day in 1840. In Kabul, the British lasted about a year and a half, after which they made a tactical withdrawal. They had hoped that they'd be able to come back, but through the Punjab. They'd been forbidden from going into Kabul from the Punjab, but by this time, Maharaja Ranjit Singh was dead, and so therefore, they had the opportunity of coming. They were picked off. One by one, about 15,000 of them were picked off by Afghan snipers. And in the end, there was only one person left, Dr. Brighton, who made his way to Jalalabad. Following Nonihal Singh in 1843 was the ebullient Anglophile Syed Singh. He loved dressing up, and you can see here that it looks as if the entire toshakhana of jewelry has been poured on him. He's sitting in the Golden Throne. He was assassinated a year and a half later, and that triggered off a whole series of murders and assassinations. The boy who came to the throne after him was Dilip Singh. He was 8 years old, or rather 5 years old at the time. And obviously, being so young, he could not control the kingdom. And it was his intrepid mother, Rani Jinda, who was described as the Messalina of the East, who in fact controlled the Punjab. And it was because of her that they violated the one treaty that mattered, which was the Sutlej as a border between the British and the Sikhs. The Sikh army crossed, and the English reciprocated by crossing the Sutlej towards Lahore. A battle took place, and the Battle of Gujarat, Gujarat in 1846 determined the initial collapse of the Sikh Empire. Rani Jinda, and in this drawing, which was done by George Richmond later in her life, just before she died, you can see she looks almost like Farida Khanum here. But Rani Jinda was then taken to exile, first to Sheikhupura Fort, which was about 22 kilometers from Lahore, but even that was too close, because from Sheikhupura Fort, she could look out towards Lahore, and she manipulated as much as she could the court of Lahore. The person who benefited from the first Sikh war was not the Sikhs, not even the British, because they didn't take over the Punjab. It was Raja Gulab Singh. He was of Jammu, and in a private treaty that he had with the British, he bought Kashmir from the British and from the Sikh Darbar for 2 crores of rupees. 75 lakhs of rupees paid in cash, and you can see the receipt in the Punjab archives, and 1 crore 25 lakhs of rupees of land that he didn't want between the Sutlej and the Bias. And he became the Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir. So if you want to spit on anybody, he's the one. Fakir Nuruddin Sahib became a member of the Regency Council for the infant Dilip Singh. And you can see, you can see him in a much diminished court with Dilip Singh, Radha Dinanath, etc. Please. Within 3 years, although it was technically the Sikh court which was in charge, but actually the British were ruling it through the resident, Henry Lawrence, there was another skirmish. And this time it was decisive at the Battle of Subrao in February 1849. The Sikh Darbar no longer functioned. The annexation of the Punjab took place in the Sheesh Mahal, and Lord Dalhousie sat in the golden throne of Maharaja Ranjit Singh and accepted the Punjab as part of the British Empire. The more palpable benefit that came was of the Kohinoor diamond. And the Kohinoor here, shown in its original casing as a bazuband. The Queen wears, the Kohinoor was then trimmed from 187 carats to 107, and the two diamonds on either side are now worn by the Queen as earrings. When Shah Shuja's wife was asked, what is the value of the Kohinoor? Shah Shuja had owned it, and Ranjit Singh had purloined it from him. I said, what's the value? She said, listen, if you take, and she was asked this by Fakir Nuruddin, if you take a stone, 5 stones, and throw one as far north as possible, one as far east or as west as possible, and one as far south, and take the 5th stone and throw it up in the sky as high as you can, and fill that space with gold, it'll still be worth less than the value of the Kohinoor. The new stone cut was 107 carats, and it was turned into a brooch, which you can see here, worn by Queen Victoria, and is now remains in the crown of the Queen's consort. The Sikhs, by this stage, with the loss of the Darbar, loss of the Sikh Empire, loss of Lahore, whereas the Sikhs once controlled history, they made history, now they were relegated to it. The empty, the stone, golden throne of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, remained empty because there was no man in the Punjab big enough to fill it. Dilip Singh was taken away to Fatehgarh, and he was accompanied there by Fakir Zahuruddin, our ancestor, my tutor, his tutor, who taught him Persian. Fakir Zahuruddin by this time, Azizuddin died in 1852. His brother Imamuddin died in 1851, 52, and 54. These three gentlemen, the three brothers, who had stood during their lifetime, shoulder to shoulder, were then laid to rest, side by side. And in, please, one of the brothers, Fakir Kamruddin Saab, was the, sent with Rani Jinda to Banaras, and he was a young boy, aged 16. And his function was to go in with the Maharani and to check whether she was still there in the tent, while the British, because obviously they couldn't go into the tent, Pardatha. Fakir Kamruddin Saab identified her, went with her to Banaras and came back, and that was the last official duty that any member of the family of that court attended as such. I'm now going to read the closing remarks, which I put in my book, and with your permission, sir, it'll just take a couple of minutes. One winter evening, more than a century ago, Nuruddin's son, Fakir Kamruddin, gathered two of his young grandchildren, as I have done this evening, two of his grandchildren, and enveloping them in his warm woolen choga, he narrated to them events of his past, of how he had traveled with the Queen of the Punjab to Banaras at such speed that the elephants went blind from the dust, of the Maharani's insistence on calling him by his pet name Dholu, of the unforgettable sight of the glittering darbars, and of the slayings and murders in the Lahore fort. He told them of the three men whom they would never see except through his eyes. His eldest uncles, Azizuddin, he's in the middle there, on the right-hand side, Imamuddin and Nuruddin. Three modest men in modest garments, with discreet manners, silken voices, and a gift for expression that made them indispensable to as discerning a ruler as Ranjit Singh. Ranjit Singh, a self-made Maharaja, knew above all the value of self-made fakirs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fakir Aijazuddin sir. You have in detail mentioned how well connected the three ancestors of yours were connected with the court of Ranjit Singh. May I begin by asking a naughty question? In what way the fakirs of today are connected with the Takht-e Lahore of today?
Not close enough. That's okay. Your
okay. I mean, your focus in your presentation had been more on the three fakirs. But I would seek to know from you, what is the significance of this period in the overall history of India? Because generally what we study and we teach to our students, there is a history of the Mughal Empire that ends at the death of Aurangzeb Alamgir, and then we talk about 1857 and Bahadur Shah Zafar, who was there. what happened in between, that is not known, or that's not a popular theme of discussion in our country. And the Punjab of Ranjit Singh falls in that period. Mm-hmm. So I would like to know what is the significance of this period in overall history of India.
All right, I'll be brief. It's a blind spot in our history, but it's a golden blind spot.
Okay.
I say golden because it was a period which we should recognize as being of unique significance. It was the first time, as I said, it was a kingdom, a finite kingdom. And the second, which to me is the more important, we had a Sikh ruler who was totally secular. He had all the communities, but particularly three prominent people, prominent religions represented in his court. You had the three Muslim brothers, whom I felt responsible to explain. He had Radha Dinanaths, etc., who were Hindus, and then he had Rana Yodhya Prashad, and he had the Sikh Dogras, who were Raja Dalip Singh and Suchet Singh, Dihan Singh, and his brother Gulam Singh. So this is the first time that there was representative governance, if you like, from all of the various the rulers and all of the major religious parties. Ranjit Singh was asked, how did he lose his single eye? And his apocryphal reply was that God wanted me to see all religions with one eye, and that is why he took away the other. Now that, I think, is something that we have to acknowledge today, that while it may be a blind spot in our history books, but it is something that we need to honor, we need to cherish, and in an appropriate way to emulate, because there has to be space for everybody in our community.
I would like to further ask how you estimate the policies of Ranjit Singh. It's a very unique period. On the one hand, you see East India Company is marching ahead, and every day some Indian territory is occupied by it. Threat was there for Punjab also. So on the one hand, this flux of East India Company. On the other hand, Ranjit Singh also wishes to assert its autonomy. How he managed to survive in that period?
Well, perhaps the best way I can answer this is to say that there had been, as I mentioned earlier, there was this treaty under which the British recognized the Sutlej as the border. The border on the western side was amorphous, as it is today. So there was a lot of comings and goings. But I suspect that the real reason why Ranjit Singh was able to control the Punjab as unequivocally as he could was that he didn't privatize it.
Okay.
He remained in control of it. He could as easily have done, he did employ a number of Firangis. There were French, there were Germans, there were Italians, there were Transylvanians, etc. But the power remained in his hands. The second thing, which is, I believe, equally important, was that he maintained a bulwark against the British. And the British recognized this. They didn't. Every other part of India had either been controlled by them or taken over by them. When I say controlled, through treaties with paramount rulers. But their paramountcy was acknowledged of the East India Company and subsequently the British, as it happened later. But as far as Ranjit Singh was concerned, that entire area, which was bigger than the United Kingdom, Punjab in those days bigger, was under the singular control, and they acknowledged that he governed and had a right to govern. So it was only after his death that then the whole map of India became red, which is what Ranjit Singh suspected would happen after his death.
But as your book tells us, there was some element of mismanagement also there in his regime. The lack of prioritizing things, which is more important. For example, at times he was not in a position to pay to his soldiers.
Yes.
And on the other hand, he's longing for British horses and trying to appease the Britishers and asking via media individuals to persuade the Britishers to send him as gift that particular color of colored horse, so on and so forth. All those details are there in your book. So, I mean, the element of mismanagement within the regime, was it not responsible for the weakening of the state?
Yes, well, let me try and answer it in this way, sir. And I'll be very brief because I think Salman Saab is following us in a few moments. It was a classic example of public poverty and private wealth. None of those people were poor. None of the Rajas, none of their, the Sardars. And so when the Sikh fell and there was an indemnity, which is what Gulab Singh paid for, they tried to raise it from the Sikh Sardars. And none of them would. And Lawrence bemoaned this and said, when each of them is worth more than this, thanks to Ranjit Singh, but none of them is coming forward. So in a sense, the only answer I can give you is, like today, the politicians are rich, the country is poor.
Yeah. Right. My second last question, okay, before I ask the last question, is about your methodology.
Yes.
I mean, this is not your first book. You have penned down other books on history also. How you worked, what are your priorities while relying on certain sources, how you do?
Well, it's given in the book, but I think the person that you should be asking that of is my wife, who had to part with me for the period that I did take to write the book. So Shanaz will give you a better answer afterwards. Gee, your last question.
So the last question is a bit a tricky one, I would say. You have chosen your ancestors as your subject.
Yes.
To what extent a professional historian can be objective while writing about one's own ancestors?
Okay, sir. Perhaps the answer in that, to that lies in Ayub Khan's reply as to when they asked him why Gauhar Ayub was making so much money. And he said, well, he's got initiative. Why should I prevent him from doing what he has a talent for? So why should I prevent my ancestors from being lauded for their achievements? So I'd have to rest my case.
Okay. Do we have time? No? Okay. Had we some time, we would have asked the audience for a couple of questions, but as you see, we don't have time. Ladies and gentlemen, sorry for that. We left no time for you people. But anyway, you have heard about a good book, and the author himself was in conversation. I thank P.R. Aijazuddin Saab and ladies and gentlemen, all of you, for being such a patient audience. Thank you.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll now be proceeding and with the next book launch. The Other Side of the Mountain by Salman Khurshid, and Ghazi Salahuddin Sahab will be in conversation with Salman Khurshid. So I request both our speakers to please join us on the stage.